Macmillan Audio presents The Midnight Dog of the Repo Man by W. Bruce Cameron, read for you by George K. Wilson. "What kind of dog doesn't want to go for a walk?" I demand of my basset houndish canine, who has responded with a sigh of disgust to my invitation for a stroll around the block. Jake's stocky legs, which are barely long enough to keep his stomach from dragging when he's upright, don't even twitch as I slap my thighs and give a low whistle. "You go." His mournful deep brown eyes seem to be saying, "I'll sleep." "Dogs love walks. It's what they live for," I insist. Jake's expression indicates he thinks those other mutts are idiots. When I kneel down to look at him more closely, stroking his huge velvet ears, he presses his eyes closed and tries to get his brown, white, and black body to blend in with the beige carpet. "Haven't you read the dog manual?"
"You can't see me. My eyes are closed."
He's a new dog, and we're still getting used to each other. Well, not new, in the sense that he recently slid down the birth canal. He made that trip maybe 8 years ago. But new to me, as is the experience of owning my own pet. The last time I lived with a dog, it was a family Labrador named Spooky, who was so determined to catch squirrels he would plunge through screen doors and leap out of car windows. I was 6 years old, and it was my job to clean up after Spooky in the backyard, which was how I knew he was supplementing his dog food diet with unauthorized enhancements such as my sister's doll clothes. Jake, however, believes squirrels should be allowed to scamper unmolested and can barely be bothered to stick his head in his bowl more than once or twice a day. So completely different from the food-frenzied lab of my childhood that I'm still having trouble getting used to it. "I know it's late, buddy, but that's what you signed up for when you came to live with a bouncer in a bar. I usually don't even get home before midnight."
"I am not a midnight dog."
"Come on, Jake. Want a treat?" Jake has integrity and cannot be bribed into any conduct he holds in contempt. "I had 3 guns stuck in my face the day I adopted you," I remind Jake in a blatant attempt to guilt him into coming with me. He groans aloud.
"Not this again."
"It's true," I insist. "Maybe not the same calendar day, but the same 24-hour period.
You owe me."
Jake decides I'm never going to shut up and lurches to his feet with a put-upon expression, grumpily following me outside into the darkness. Bugs are singing, and a light breeze tickles the leaves in the trees overhead, though the splendors of such a perfect summer night are lost on my dog, who feels the whole forced march ordeal should be kept as short as possible. It's August, and Jake has been my companion since early June. I'm no longer worried that his ex-owner is going to come try to steal him back. When I tell people the story of how my dog came to live with me, I always start with the 2 guns that were pointed in my direction at just past 10 in the evening, the day before I met Jake. It's a tenuous connection, to be sure, but to me it all links together logically. I'm certain I would never have adopted Jake if it hadn't been for the men with the shotguns. There's not much for me to do as the bouncer in the Black Bear Bar in Kalkaska, Michigan. Picture a small town, a failing saloon, and me in the corner, a big grumpy guy nursing beers and grudges in equal measure. And you pretty much have the scene. I was sitting by myself at a table watching my sister Becky watch the only 2 patrons in the place, a couple of pretty ladies named Stasia Gaffney and Cora Sins. Becky is the person who involuntarily contributed the doll wardrobe to Spooky's diet back when we were kids, a bit of information I have never shared with her, preferring to hold it back so I can spring it on her at an opportune moment, like maybe when I'm losing an argument. Becky is master of the forlorn look. For as long as I can remember, she's been a little sad, her mouth pulled small, and her brown eyes shadowed. The random lottery in the womb won me my dad's DNA. So I grew past 6 feet in high school, 200 pounds of muscle that could hit the line hard and fast, a football tucked under my right arm. Since then, I've let the biceps go a little soft and packed on another 20 pounds or so. But I still can intimidate drunks when I need to. Becky is as petite as my mother and was shy and unpopular growing up, everyone always asking her if she really was Ruddy McCann's sister, because she seemed so different. She owns the black bear, and I could read her calculations as she regarded Stasia's and Cora's painfully slow consumption of Pinot Grigio. Another night when the income fell short of the outgo, money-wise, Becky's forlorn look was not without cause. I figured that by the end of the week I could kick in a few extra bucks to help her enterprise. I'm not just a bar bouncer. I have a far more glitzy occupation during the day. I'm the local repo man. Stasia lifted her glass and took a tiny sip. She was drinking so slowly she was losing more wine to evaporation than consumption. Becky and I exchanged.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.